everyone. Welcome to our ReStream broadcast of two recent performances of Ensemble New SRQ. Tonight, April 13th at 8 p.m., would have been our performance of Digital Trees for you at First Congregational Church here in Sarasota. And while we can't be with our beloved audience in person and our musical colleagues, we do hope that this offering of two broadcasts of archival performances from recent seasons of ours will serve as a placeholder until we can be together again playing music.
First up, we actually have, and we're very excited about this, a short interview with composer Nina C. Young, whose work Rising Tide we performed with some collaborators from Hub New Music back in October of 2018. And secondly, we have a performance of Krzysztof Penderecki's monumental Sextet, which was actually from this current season back in October.
We remember Penderecki as he recently passed away, the eminent Polish composer. And this is our small way of saying thanks to him for the great music. Hi, everyone. We're thrilled to have composer Nina C. Young here with us. We performed her excellent work, Rising Tide, back in October 2018, and we're sharing the ReStream with you of that right after this. But we just wanted to say hi to Nina, who's in New York first.
Hello.
Hi, guys.
We'd love it if you could just kind of introduce yourself to our audience, tell them what you love about music and your path and anything you'd like to share with them.
Okay, sure. Well, I guess I identify as a composer, but I write instrumental work, I write electronic work, I write stuff that combines the two, and I've been doing more sort of cross-disciplinary and installation-based work recently. I have a background, actually, like trained in my undergrad as an engineer in ocean engineering, so shipbuilding, which is maybe not like what you think about when it comes to music.
Cool.
But when I was a kid, I played violin. And so I have a deep love of classical music and the repertoire, but also sort of a creative impetus to like try different things out. And so when I'm writing music, I really think about it as kind of problem solving and engineering, where I'm putting unlike things together and trying to make these situations and these environments and looking at every person and their personality, every instrument and how they work and trying to see different combinations. So I actually don't think it's very different than what I was doing before. It's just the medium is sound.
Nice.
That's awesome.
That's fantastic. And it's interesting that you mentioned installations, that that's the direction you've gone into now. I certainly can hear some of those directions, at least in Rising Tide, at least in the way the structures are built. And when I look at the score and you can kind of see how things unfold and kind of creating these tapestries of sound or you know, an idea of that texture and those layers. So that's something you've gone into even more recently, it sounds like.
Yeah, even more recently. In concert music, I kind of think about every phrase is a way to sort of wash over the musicians and the audiences and like bring you into this magical world that doesn't really exist. But we get to suspend our disbelief for a little bit when we're in a concert together in time. And I'm always fascinated with the concert hall. Like, you sit in different positions in the hall and your sonic experience is different. When you're playing inside an ensemble, you're hearing a different perspective of the piece depending on like who you're next to and what the space is like. And these are really fascinating ways of kind of considering the different perspectives of environment that you can have from like one piece that's happening at a fixed moment in time. And so I've been trying to explore the relationship of how we can make that more immersive. And this isn't a new thing to classical music. I mean, if we look at the way even polyphony developed with the development of the Gothic cathedral and the idea that sounds can have reverbs and delays and hockets and conversations between players, between musicians, between vocalists, and how they resonate in this space. I think that's been part of our history and kind of how harmony really developed. And so now I'm just trying to unpackage that in the other direction.
Awesome.
Neat. Yeah, I think that it's so effective how you're able to create resonance within the work and resonance in Rising Tide in particular that sustains through other ideas. And it's kind of this connective tissue that that continues and lets the mood and the evocative nature of that evolve. And one of those things, which we want to talk about, which is a little bit of an extended technique, is this Ebo. And we're going to show everyone what the Ebo looks like. We'll have a picture of it here at this point.
Right, but
the
here.
Ebo.
Here is an Ebo.
And it's, I think it's originally destined for guitars, right?
Yeah, for electric guitars, yeah.
Yeah, and so it's a little device that Connor, you'll see in the video, puts into the piano on certain pitches of the piano, and that the electronic frequency allows that pitch to sustain and resonate in a way that is unnatural for the piano. But how did you arrive at kind of doing this or using this technique?
Well, I'm really interested in resonance. It's been a big thing of mine. I grew up down the street from a church that had a really cool bell tower in it. And so like my first sonic memories are these bells and hearing their attacks and then how they would sustain over time. As you can see, I'm still obsessed with that. I have wind chimes and bells hanging all over the place in my apartment. So the idea of metal percussion and resonance, I have this instrument called the Marvin on top of my piano, which is made by this guy named Adam Warford in Colorado. He makes these really cool metal percussion instruments. What I really love about that is if I put the sustain pedal down on my piano and I play, not only am I getting this resonance from the piano, but the Marvin adds all these extra resonances too.
Nice.
And so I think that like what I was saying before about installations and space, I think, you know, resonance defines the kind of environment and the atmosphere we're in. And so in Rising Tide, I was trying to figure out a way to make a conversation between the instruments that can sustain and those who can't really quite the same way. And I thought, well, you know, string instruments, they can theoretically bow forever and create these very gentle glowing sounds that even increase in volume over time. Woodwind instruments can also do that. With percussion, you can do it with bowing techniques as well. But the piano, we always have an attack and we kind of can't do the reverse fade that we can in electronic music. But you can with this Ebo, because the Ebo is a little electric magnet and you put it on a string, you hover it over a string, and then it starts to vibrate the string very gently. And you'll hear this glow emerge from the piano. And in Rising Tide, there's kind of two central pitches. There's an A flat G sharp and an E natural. And those are sort of the magnets or the boundaries and borders around which everything else rotates, these sort of two poles. Mm-hmm. And those are the two pitches that get the Ebos and the pianos. And I was trying to think of a way to have the piano resonate and sing where we're not really sure where the sound is coming from, but then when everybody stops, you get to hear this glow occurring that's an unnatural resonance, and maybe eventually you key into the idea that it's coming from the piano. I also, Connor did such a beautiful performance, but this piece is like a ballet for the pianist. I almost think it's a piano concerto, and you get to watch the pianist literally pull the sounds out of the instrument. And I think that's kind of cool, because sometimes in ensemble, the piano gets lost in the background to everybody else.
It's true.
It can happen.
It can happen. Never with Connor, though.
Yeah.
No.
You mentioned Connor Hannock, who's a frequent collaborator of ours and also of yours. Somebody that we've both been able to work with a lot. And you've been a New York-based composer for some years. And I know that Connor and yourself are really involved in a similar group to ours in terms of structure and what it looks like with Ensemble Échappé.
Yeah.
And it's just so cool for us, a lot of the same players that we see sometimes that come down and visit us have just been with you guys and have just performed works. And it's so fun to have these multiple groups now that 5 years ago didn't exist, 5 or 6 years ago didn't exist, that now, you know, we have all this interplay between. And
well, I think that's a really great conversation. I mean, we met at Tanglewood in 2013 or something like that. You see these sort of like, I guess, generations of musicians and how everybody disperses all over the place, but then we get these new connections. So I think actually because of Rising Tide, I'm now writing a piece for Hub New Music.
Oh, great.
We're like working on a pretty big project that's a little bit more performance arty than just like concert performance. And I think it's really cool. But yeah, I love these overlaps. And I think that's a really beautiful thing. I think sometimes our music community can become very siloed, but these sort of conversations where we can make connections and sort of spread these ideas and this joy for what we do. I mean, you guys started an ensemble. It's not easy work.
Yes, it's another full-time job. Yes,
another full-time job. And it creates a beautiful opportunity, and it's also a labor of love. And to share these across locales and across shared friends is really beautiful.
Well, what was fun about this performance also is because it actually was from our collaborative concert with Hub New Music when we brought them down here to Sarasota. And that was another great opportunity to work with old friends and now make new friends in that process. Mm-hmm. And just like reinforce these connections. It feels like our world, especially down here in Florida, that we're all a little bit more connected to, like you said, the generation of musicians that kind of have been growing out of this recent, 10 years, I think, of festivals and schooling together and
yeah, Sarasota's become a hotspot for sure.
Yeah, it's certainly grown since we first arrived. That was eight years ago. Yeah. And we've been instigating the whole time. I want to just pivot one final question. In light of everything that everyone is going through right now. I know that for me personally, this time away from performing on the stage has given me the ability and the time to look a little bit differently at music and revisit some music that I didn't have time for, and has kind of stopped the 10 projects ahead of me that I had to do because we had scheduled them, and I've been able to look at other music and do other things. Has this time given you any different looks compositionally at what's coming up, or even musically given you some time to look at other stuff? I know that you just had an incredible commission and Project 19 performance at the New York Guild.
I'm so grateful that happened. A month ago.
Otherwise. Absolutely. That was so recent. But has this time kind of changed your thought pattern, or are you just digging into music more and writing more? How has it changed?
Well, the first little while was actually really tough because I felt kind of like Woody the Woodpecker, like running off is that who it is? Who's the one?
Roadrunner?
Roadrunner, yeah. So like Roadrunner running off a cliff, and like you just keep on going.
Yeah.
This was actually going to be the busiest spring season that I've ever had. I just did a project with the New York Phil Ensemble Echappé. I had a bunch of concerts that were coming up. I had a big installation performance piece with the American Brass Quintet and 372 Speakers in the Sky at MPAC that was supposed to happen. And then a 35-minute piece for voice, orchestra, and electronics and video at Carnegie Hall. So it took me a week to, because I felt like I was preparing for this creative marathon, and then for everything to stop for a second, I felt so out of time with myself. So it required me to slow down and something, I wanted time to create, but I also needed time to think. And I've been sort of going back to more core values. Like I'm not a pianist, but I've been playing piano every day. And I'm doing these like new coding tutorials. But one of the things I'm finding really difficult is actually to compose right now. And I think because my heart is broken.
Mm. Yeah.
I do a lot of computer and electronic music. So in some ways I should be like, oh, well, I should just create a bunch of music that we can listen to online with headphones. And I realize that that's not really satisfying for me. I want to be in a communal space with people gathering, and live performance is really like what brings me joy in creation. And so I think if anything, this time away from community has made me realize how important it is for us as humans to gather communally and appreciate sound together. And I know this is going to redefine the landscape of how we make. And we're going to start making different kinds of work for different media, but it's very important, I think, that we hold on to this, the beauty of humans playing music together and sharing it and listening it, and not find substitutes for that will completely override that joy.
Yeah. Absolutely. Beautiful thoughts. Thank you. I've found myself also, for the most part, sitting at the piano. Yep. I started as a pianist years ago, and I haven't had much time to, find
that's time so curious
piano, but it's just like I like find, you know, we've been reading violin sonatas, you know, the mm-hmm. two of us, just mm-hmm. unknown material to us from, you know, across the centuries, and just really digging into that and finding nourishment from it.
Yeah, finding nourishment from hearing the vibrations like mm-hmm. go through you. Yeah,
absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Nina.
Thank you so,
thanks so much
for chatting with us.
And we're gonna, I know that I love this performance that we're about to share with everybody, and we hope you all enjoy it too. Thanks again.
Thank you so much for performing and for sharing this work, Aiden. It's so great to see you guys on Zoom.
Of course, likewise, likewise.
Prominent Polish composer Krzysztof Penderecki passed away recently on March 29th. We actually played a piece of his, the monumental Sextet, earlier this season, and we'd like to present that archival recording as a tribute to his legacy.
This sextet by Krzysztof Penderecki formed one of the three building blocks of this season that we had constructed. Penderecki's Sextet, Messiaen's Colors of the Celestial City, and Grisez's Vortex Temporum, which ultimately we were not able to perform, but will be rescheduled for next season. But the sextet by Penderecki, as you'll notice as we go through this performance with you, is an incredible work, a sprawling work, one of various characters and colors and different ideas and moods that he sets up, and is one that really has paved an incredible way forward in music.
Penderecki's compositional style changed throughout his life, and the sextet is an example of sort of his return to tonality that he came to later in life, very much like Arvo Pärt, who similarly started out with a much more avant-garde and dissonant compositional style, and actually arrived later in life at this sort of more tonally centered, sort of traditional approach, in the sense that they weren't using these avant-garde techniques of the 60s and 70s. Penderecki's music was also featured in a lot of films, and he kind of had a connection, a space connection, and I just learned this, and I'm very excited to know that there is a main belt asteroid named in his honor. I think it's 21680. So now when you look up at the night sky and happen to see an asteroid passing over, it just know that it could be Penderecki.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all again so much for joining us virtually. We hope to be back with you performing very soon and can't wait for that date to come. One last thing before we go, we wanted to remind you all of the upcoming Giving Challenge, which is a 24-hour online giving event that happens this April 28th to 29th, noon to noon. And it's an opportunity for everyone to come together and support the local nonprofits in our area. And it's very helpful for us in terms of our fundraising for seasons going forward. So we hope that you can join us for that. And the website is givingpartnerchallenge.org.
Perhaps some of you are at home, maybe cooking some dinner or enjoying a beverage or relaxing. We plan on doing the same thing now after our performances. And we're going to go over to Instagram Live at our Ensemble New SRQ page. If you can, take a moment, stop by, and we'll have a little virtual reception and catch up.